suppose the public perception of him is that he can be a bit of an asshole. But to the Ealing crew, no, he was always cool with us. Never, never a problem.
You can take the man out of Ealing, but you can't take Ealing out of the man. Jay'll always be an Ealing boy.
Well, he's a lovely fella, but he can also be a right real fucking pain in the arse, you know. So, anywhere between those two extremes.
Ealing, West London. A multicultural borough of leafy streets and parks, famous for its Broadway, its studios and its common. Ealing is where the Rolling Stones played their first gig. It's also where JK grew up. Skateboarding, clubbing, blagging cigarettes and squatting flats. Ealing is where Jay formed Jamiroquai in 1991. Going from squat to mansion. In 10 years, he sold 23 million albums. But now it's time to come home, to where it all began. Homecoming, a one-off gig of a lifetime. A stadium band at their first venue, playing their greatest hits close up in front of 300 of their biggest fans.
Yeah, well, I spent more time in Ealing than I did anywhere else. Ealing, Acton, Shepherd's Bush. You know, I mean, I've got a lot of memories of the place. I mean, I don't really go back there much, to be honest. That was where the whole thing was cultivated.
It's 10 o'clock and Jay is leaving his Buckinghamshire home on a journey back to Ealing. It's been 10 years since he played a venue this small and the day has started badly.
Last night, JK, the lead singer of the pop group Jamiroquai, was involved in a serious brawl at the after-show party for the latest Star Wars premiere. The incident occurred after the millionaire singer accused the photographer Alan Grisbrook of denting his brand new £170,000 Bentley. Grisbrook reportedly headbutted Kay before horrified onlookers pulled the two apart. The bloodied singer gave the police a full statement at his Buckinghamshire mansion this morning. He told them that he was determined to go ahead with his homecoming concert tonight, despite the upset.
Here's somebody else on a bloody mobile phone.
Yes, I'm all right. My nose hurts a little bit, but I'm not concerned about my nose. I'm more concerned about the dent in the bloody motor. All right, speak to you later, mate. Bye. How many things are going on in the world that are really, really important, and yet News at 10 want to cover my bloody nose? I mean, you've got to laugh, haven't you? You know, the world's gone fucking mad. You want to talk about my nose? Why? Come on, it's only a nose, man.
Jay is pretty much exactly the same now as when I first met him. He really hasn't changed. I mean, obviously, you know, he's got the success and he's got a bit of wealth behind him. But he's essentially the same person, and that's somebody who can be a pain in the arse sometimes, who can be pissed off sometimes, who can be happy sometimes. He's just like a human being, really. But he's not one of these manufactured kind of smile, give the right answer, be trained. I mean, as his PR, I attempted to train Jay in sort of giving the kind of anodyne answers to questions, non-controversial answers, and it's just impossible because what you see is what you get with him. If he's in a bad mood on the day you're interviewing him, you'll get somebody in a bad mood. If he's happy and excited, you'll get someone who's happy and excited.
Where are we going? This is Ealing. This is where I used to live. Christ.
God, this is bringing it all home. Blimey. Now we're getting to the real nitty gritty. We're approaching Ealing Broadway. And thank you very much, my love. What a charming looking lady in a nice BMW like that. What do you know about that? God, summer. Brings all the girls out. Right. Okay, now this place here is where I spend most of my time from, I'd say, well, 14, 15. This is the alleyway that I used to walk up to get home, right? Every day I used to come down on my skateboard. God, it's really bringing back memories. And this is when I was about 17, and this is where I kind of used to sing to myself. Because it was quiet, as you can see, so you could burst out without anybody else hearing you. All we did all day was skateboard. Skate, 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 skate to live. That's what we all did. I never went anywhere without skateboard.
just go up to Ladbroke Grove and go skating, go to little house parties, get Righteous, a can of special brew, large joint, over the days.
I first met Jay in, would have met him in sort of 87, 88 at Linford Studios, where we used to do one of the Kiss FM nights. And Jay used to dance about on the stage. He used to come every week and he'd be on the stage doing his Jamiroquai spacewalk type thing. But it was an acid house club. So it was going off at 130 BPM. He was on the front of the stage doing this half beat, half time dancing. So it looked like he was moving in slow motion. And we used to keep him up there all the time. We used to have a guy that used to throw all the twats and all these like arm jerking freaks. We used to throw him back into the crowd, but we always used to keep Jay up because he was so entertaining.
We're going down here, are we? Because this is the Ealing Broadway Centre service, so we used to skate up here. This is where we used to skate here. We never lasted more than 5 minutes before the geezer come along. Are we in here? Great, look at that. What do you know? What do you know? Love it. God.
Stand above on the left, yeah?
I used to want to skateboard it, nobody would let me. Oh, yeah. That'll do. Oh, shit, I forgot I'm doing a gig tonight. I'm not just showing you around either.
Groovy.
About that, come back from the brink with a broken nose and all the rest of it, and look, you never know. The beautiful thing is, I didn't go down. It's amazing, you know, being a pop star these days, you can afford the nose surgery the next day. It's just wonderful. As you know, I used to live in Ealing. I used to live here, caused lots of trouble on these very same hallowed streets that you're on now. So, have a good time, boogie down, and hopefully I won't sing like that. Right, let's do it. With a sunshine smile upon my face, my friends are close at hand, and all my inhibitions have disappeared without a trace. I'm glad, all that I found, yeah, somebody who I can't rely on. This is the return of the space cowboy, and to play that terrier, you're about to hold. To get high, just to get by. I'm coming down, I can see clearly, so high in the sky. A man with psychedelic picture frames, how about us to shit his eyes? He's been hard that I found, yeah, somebody who he can rely on. This is the return of the space cowboy, interplanetary.
Same area in West London, Ealing. W5. And Jay, as I remember, he was always on skates, always wacky, off the wall, but basically, you know, good kid. I had no inkling at that time that he could sing, but I knew he was a dancer boy.
It all rolled in, you know, all these sort of ideas and things, and the way I danced and the way I did things all came from these formative years. And dancing came from, you know, probably being off my trolley at festivals and the rave years, you know, kind of a mixture of skating and boogie, you know. Get so high.
To me, he is the living personification of Mick Jagger, James Brown, Stevie Wonder, all rolled into one. He has the X factor.
I mean, I never really thought that it wouldn't be successful. Kind of where the hats came into and things like that. You know, I knew that I could wear a hat and then not be recognised when I was out the street, which was kind of cool, you know. So I kind of took that precaution early on. I used to do a lot of too. I used to do an awful lot of that back when I was a naughty boy. Yeah! Now this is where Monsieur's career actually did kind of start. This is Haven Green. We're going to have to take a walk around, boys and girls. What fun! This is where... It's the worst time to come here, isn't it? School kid time. Nice one. Hi, girl. Oh, you got paper in there, look. Thanks very much.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Okay, bye. Can I kiss you again?
Yeah.
No.
Ronan, man. I'm just explaining to these dear people here. So what used to be my haunt. Exactly that bench that you were sitting on right there.
God, we used to go for school.
And then I used to spend an awful lot of time outside in Broadway Station over there. Because we had no money, we would go out to people. Excuse me, I don't suppose you've got a spare cigarette at all. Some of you watching this programme may have given me a cigarette. If you did in those days, thank you. I'm a fucking addict now. Thank you very much. They weren't easy days either, you know. Those days I don't like to remember too much, you know. Let's face it, it's not exactly something that makes you proud, being a bean sprout packer in Park Royal. I got into kind of trouble. I was getting into a lot of fights and I'd had enough of it. I'd had a lot of time homeless, you know. I got arrested a couple of times for squatting. I was getting older and I thought, what am I going to do? Because there's not really a great deal I can do apart from sing. But then again, that required an element of criminal activity to get the money to buy the equipment.
Now that road down there, that is where I wrote When You're Going to Learn, down that road there.
Okay, we haven't done this for a long time, so if we screw it, then we'll just do it again. In fact, we haven't done it for so long, I've got the lyrics pinned down there, so if you see my eyes going, I'm not actually looking at some girl's tits in the front row, I'm actually looking at the lyrics, you know. Okay, this tune is When You're Gonna Learn, first one I ever did.
Rhodesia, which is now Zimbabwe, in the 70s, they had an elephant cull. It was just horrific, you know, all from helicopter, and they were just shooting, you know, whole herds of elephant. And then I saw an old Cree Indian saying, last fish has been poisoned, last thing, you know. You realise that you cannot eat money, you know. And that was kind of really sort of, you know, something that I could put to use, you know.
Have you heard the news today? People right across the world. Circumstances brought us here. I'm a gift that's come too near. Too near. Now far time is a monarchy. To see my children's destiny. The consequences are so grave. So, so grave. The hypocrites we are their slaves. So my best is not the end. On each other we depend. Yeah, 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 yeah. We got to stop it going on. We mind is on the menu at my favorite restaurant. Well, don't talk about quality. There's no fish left in the sea. Greedy men been killing all the life that ever was. And you better play it this way, or she will take it all away. Don't try to tell me you know more than her that life about. Now you've upset the balance and done the only thing you can. Now my life is in your hands.
The Jamiroquai name came from the Iroquois Indians. I just found it an interesting word. I mean, I've misspelt it. It wasn't meant to be a copied thing. You know, I didn't want to be Apache Indian. And it kind of, you know, reflected the look in a way, you know. Remember when I first came out, the people said, Jamiroquai? Nobody's going to be able to say that. Can we come up with something else? I was like, no.
One day, my partner comes around to my flat in King's Cross and played me a tape. Someone singing in their bedroom. He said, well, how about we go into management? And I thought it was a black girl. I've gone, well, it sounds a good idea, but I don't know how much mileage there is in managing an English black girl. He's gone, nah, it's a fella. I've gone, okay, can see a few more angles to work there, and then he writes his own music. Okay, right, it's Jay. You're joking, it's just, what, little, yeah. Cut a long story short, me and my partner decided to make a demo for Jay. Put in £250 each. That was what kicked it all off.
So the first radio interview I ever did, I think, was in Birmingham. The American guy said, hey, so who's this amazing black woman singer you have with you? And I went, no, mate, you know, that's me. You know, like, oh, yeah, I know you have the band, but who's this woman singing? I said, no, that's me.
We'd all grown up together because it was that West London connection. And then Jay came in as sort of the younger brother or cousin of, and I loved the music, and in particular his lyrics. I really loved what he was saying at that time, and they were so heartfelt.
He really wanted to give that message to the world. And we believe him.
In the early days, it was just part of this kind of extended acid jazz family that included all kinds of weird people like Stella McCartney and Kate Moss and, you know, I don't know, loads of people. It was kind of a good time, but I think Jay was always the one who had the artistic commitment.
No, right, this is Avon Stables, right? And they didn't want to let people like us in, really. It was acid housey time and everybody was there. This place used to be jam-packed. People with speakers out of the back of cars and vans and stuff, really giving it the large salad, as it were. And this was just hedonistic green.
Best night I've had out with Jay. I've had too many. God. We had a great time in Switzerland once. But anyway, no, I'm not going into that.
As to stories that I could tell, there's probably not many.
Boy, we had some good times in those 90s. Just thinking about it's making me smile. We had some great times. And some really, really good times.
Nah, you go fucking mental. That's about four that I've now had to quickly flash through my head and get rid of.
Okay, remember this one?
The best song I've ever written. In terms of how ahead of its time, I think it was, and what it's about is Virtual Insanity. Because, I mean, that was released on the same day that Dolly the Sheep was born. It's a wonder man can eat at all when things are big that should be small. You know, the whole idea of genetically engineering them to taste, look, feel better. And then doing it with humans as well, you know. Now every mother can choose the colour of her child. And it's not a million miles away from it. And I just think it was just ahead of it, you know, very much ahead. And now the
changing for the worse. It's a crazy world we're living in, and I just can't see that if I put some rest in sin, it's all we have to give. These futures made of virtue and insanity now always seem to be governed by this love we have for useless twisting of a new technology. Oh, now there is no sound, but we all live underground. And I'm thinking what a mess we're in, hard to know where to begin. If I can slip the sinking ties and wrap them man has made, and now every mother can't choose the color of her child. That's not nature's way. Well, that's what they said yesterday. There's nothing left to do but pray. I think it's time to find a new religion. Whoa, I'm so insane to synthesize another strain. There's something in these futures that we have to feed. The futures made of virtue and insanity. For we all live underground, you know we're just living in virtual insanity. We're living in virtual insanity. We're living in virtual insanity. That's what we're living in. Yeah. Well, it's all right now.
Yes, mate.
Nice one, mate.
What's in it? Cash?
Yeah, there's cash in there, mate. That's
well,
right.
Come on, give us the cash.
You don't need it.
No, I do.
I'll send your motors.
How do you think I'll run it?
I'll swap my bus one of your motors.
I'll rob bus drivers to run it. That's the whole idea.
Yeah, nice one.
The very beginning, cars is one of his passions, but boy, I've had some car problems.
Obviously, the first time I was ever in a car with Jay sticks in my memory.
I bought a great fat cigar, one of those great big mafia jobs, and he said to me, why don't you come and have a ride in the Ferrari?
If you're not used to being driven by somebody extremely fast in a Ferrari.
Before I know it, vroomph, we're off.
Weaving in and out of the kind of slow-moving traffic.
We couldn't have touched the floor.
Yeah, well, you know, you do tend to fear for your life.
When we finally got to a traffic island and we had to slow right down to stop, my fat cigar had whittled its way right the way down and was burning my knuckles. And that must have been all in about 500 yards, I think.
Yeah, I do like it. It's the tits. I don't care. You know, you get one life. Where we're going back now, I see some of the guys, they're in the same place that they were 12 years ago. Like, I cruise through that, and they're standing in exactly the same place, doing the same things, you know. You get one life. Use it. Enjoy it.
So the first proper car I bought was a Mercedes-Benz 280 SE convertible. I loved it. Yeah, that was happening. I mean, because nobody at 22 had one of those. Oh, well, that was one of the youngest people ever to be insured for a Lamborghini or for an Aston Martin even. Them fellas over there. You know, I mean, motor cars for me make me smile, you know. They make the bad days seem better. She's cosmic. Oh yeah, she's cosmic. Damn that song, she's so cosmic. She wants to let her go. Was called a pants and never on a Saturday in 1999.
spinning on that frequency. Yeah. Oh, don't you know, she's got that girl sarcasm. She's so classic. Sends me in a hyper space when I see her pretty face. Sends me in a hyper space when I see her pretty face.
We're doing a video for Cosmic Girl, and he had his Lamborghini. There's only six of these cars in the country. And the fella who used to look after the cars decides to give it the big and take his kid out in Jay's car. Totals it in about how many concrete bollards. Gone. Car's finished. I'm phoning up Jay. Jay, you know, don't worry, I'll take care of it. I managed to buy one of the other five of these cars. Exactly the same car. Don't let anyone drive my new car. Of course I wouldn't let anyone drive your new car, not after what's just happened. Director's on the phone saying, look, need to do some shots before you bring Jay to do his thing. Don't let him drive the car. We've got no video. No, can't let anyone. Precision drivers. Okay, do it. Phone rings. Hello, it's so-and-so in Spain. Yeah, what? You're just not going to believe what's happened. He's like, okay, the precision driver was coming around a corner, just lost it at 30 miles an hour. The windscreen's come in, the front wing's gone. God, do not go, Jay, I've got some bad news. Jesus Christ, fucking hit the roof. We had like a God knows how many hours screaming session. Anyway, did the video, the gig the next day. He only performed for 20 minutes because his voice was so knackered from screaming at me. He had to apologise, we had to go back and do another show at the place, you know.
Right, here's a good one. My first record deal was with a bloke called Morgan Khan from Street Sounds. I've cocked this up, this way. Okay, right, down here, this is where my very first record deal ever did happen. And it was with Street Sounds, who used to put out all the hip-hop albums in the 80s. So, I got three white labels out of Morgan. And I said, look, what the fuck is going on? You know, why have we only got three fucking white labels? He said, look, you come in here in your Technicolor fucking dream coat. Fucking who the fuck do you think you are? Who the fuck do you think you are? And then we've got a record deal and I'm giving it a large one. You silly boy.
I think obviously his childhood had a massive effect on the person, the artist that he is now, watching his mum perform on stage and sing in places all around the world. I think that instilled in him a very kind of almost old-fashioned sort of very professional approach to what he's doing. So although you've got this kind of sometimes seemingly out of control kind of rock star persona going on, you've also got the other side to Jay, which he definitely gets from his mum, which is a really focused professional attitude to what he's doing.
All this was Street Sounds Records. It's now First Transnational Translations. What the fuck they do, I do not know. Blimey, look this here. And this was a little rat run we used to get away from the police when they used to come up and we were being naughty, doing magic mushrooms and the like. Never come across a policeman doing magic mushrooms. It is a terrible thing to do. So anyway, I saw these guys shifting all the stuff out. You know. I said, where's Morgan? So he's gone. He's just disappeared. Geezer just left. Hello, working hard. What goes on in here? Mark Urisa. Oh, I used to do, oh God. Oh, look. Only I could get a copy of that, couldn't I? Lovely. She looks good though, doesn't she? She looks good. Right, here we go then. Love philosophy. Let's have it.
where I feel at home, on the stage. It comes to being a bit of a show-off, really, you know? And I think I just taught myself to know how to work the audience. Comes up from my mum, you know. My mum was performing when I was in her stomach, so I'm sure that that comes from there. Mind you, saying that, I don't like it anymore, but you know, in those days it was great to be the centre of attention. I mean, the other thing about being on stage was this endless stream of birds, which I thought was wonderful. I thought this was a whole new patch of my life, which was amazing. Do a gig, have a shag, I thought it was brilliant, you know, I'd never come across anything like that. So, that was good.
It's amazing when you're younger, when you're a kid, how small your world is, and to think that your whole life revolved around this fucking square of green. It's just stupid, isn't it? And I tell you what, I'm not joking. If they're still doing chicken kebabs, they fucking are as well. I'm having a chicken kebab, bollocks. Hold up, Mr. Mannering. Yeah, we can't just wait here and get a chicken kebab. We'll have to come back. But I used to have a chicken kebab and I used to skate Ealing Broadway. Look, I mean, just look, it's just buzzing along, man.
Okay. Corner of the earth.
How is Jay now compared to back then? He's more reclusive, but that's what fame does to you. Jay was always such an outgoing person, and now not being able to walk the streets obviously constricts him. But, you know, I see him have a good time now and again. A few of the festivals, when he gets to run around and lose his bouncers, he has a great time.
Little darling, don't you see the sun is shining just for you? You can get a ray on you. Come with me just to play.
I think Corner of the Earth is not only it's a fantastic song, but I think it is Jay telling us where he is now and telling us of the piece he's trying to achieve now. Like When You're Gonna Learn, it's a song that really comes from the soul.
This corner of me, and feels like me in many ways. I can sit for hours, sit and watch it ever better display.
I bought this like 4 or 5 years ago. The first house was built in 1086. That was William the Conqueror's half-brother, I believe. It was Stephen the First, King of England. And I bought it to a large extent because of the garden. It was designed in 1780 by Humphrey Repton, who's up there with Capability Brown. These are the great garden designers of the 18th century. And he did a pretty good job, didn't he?
What's next on this thrilling menu? Something that you people got to number 3 in the chart. It's called Little Earl.
never get your head around the fact that me and you in love is dead. See how I'm tripping out, 'cause you can't decide what you really want from me.
Rarely see somebody who's got, you know, the talent, the looks, the moves, the dress sense, the stage presence, the star quality. You know, this guy's got the whole works.
Frankly, he was a star from the day we first saw him, and I wouldn't be at all surprised if he's going to be a star long, long, long into the future.
You need music that's accessible, easy melodies. You know, in some quarters he's been, you know, labelled as someone who's just formulaic. Every album sounds the same. Yeah, you listen to the Beatles, listen to James Brown, same thing. Why change a winning formula? 20-odd million albums down the line, who's right in the end?
He's a superstar, but he's still Jay, I think. I don't think he's got any airs and graces. He's just sort of enjoying the spoils of all his hard work.
He's fundamentally the same, but in a much bigger way. He's like three times bigger in terms of his projection of his personality, but he'd always been kind of the same, kind of cheeky, irreverent, cocky little superstar, even when he was had 50p and a bus pass in his pocket.
The problem with Jay is he's gone past the media, as in the music press. He's actually turned into a celebrity, and the people who hound him now are the tabloids, and he's great fodder for them. And I think that's a real shame, you know, because they hound him, and he's a private person. You know, he doesn't want people to know where he's been or what he's drunk or who he's been with. He wants them to know what songs he's written. Jay would love to have the anonymity of being able to run around the streets and be the boy he always was. And is. I don't think he'll ever change.
I just feel like I've spent 12 years of my life living out of a bag. You know, all I see is a hotel door. Sometimes I don't even know what pseudonym I used for the last hotel. This is the price you pay. I don't get to sense any normality. I can't really go anywhere without people knowing who I am. And sometimes you don't want people to know who you are. You know, you just don't. You just want to be anonymous. It's just constantly non-stop harassment, you know. It's part of the territory, but I'm saying, it doesn't mean to say you have to enjoy it all the time. Some people love it. I've had enough of that to last me a lifetime. I do think about the day when I have stopped this and people don't recognise, you know, I think I should quite look forward to that, because I'll have done my bit, you know, I'll have done it.
Let me get one thing straight. You can ask any musician or singer or anybody in this business who's to go around the world. You know, everybody thinks it's some cushy job and you go around the world. You know what it's like? You step on a bus, you step with all the other people in the band, yeah? You step off that bus, you go and do the show, you get back on that bus and you travel all the way through the night. You might wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning, you get 3 hours in a hotel and then you're up again to do press, promotion, all the rest. Talking about yourself all the time as well, which can do your nutting. And, you know, and anybody thinks that isn't hard work, the first year's great, you know, sure, you shag everything that moves and it's wonderful, you know what I mean? And then after that, it kind of loses its shine a bit. And also, you know, as James Brown said, paid the cost of being boss, you know? And everyone that gets paid, from the band right down to the guy who puts the garden, comes out of that pocket there. And that's tough. And aside from that, you know, the temptations that there are, you know, the drink, drugs, whatever else, you know, it's not easy. You know, it's worth it, but there are prices to be paid for everything. And I just feel very alone sometimes. I don't have a, you know, wife and kids and all things like that, so there's nothing really to come back to except those two pillocks down there. Okay, fine, sure, we're sitting in this nice car now, wonderful, you know, I've got a house back there. Okay, but it can all go tomorrow. Know It Record, record company, whee! Drop, bye-bye. Because they're not going to stick around. I mean, it was bad enough for me. I mean, the pressure I felt doing Too Young to Die, the first single for Sony, was just unreal. Thinking, if this doesn't get, I mean, in the end it got to number 10 first, straight off. Great, did us a favour. But the pressure I felt trying to get that right was unreal. Everybody. Don't want no war, no. To have won a Grammy is great. You don't get them for nothing, and you've got to be a bit good to get one. To win the Video of the Year is a great achievement, something that I'll be able to show my kids, you know. Winning the Ivor Novello Award for songwriting achievements, that was a big thing. Something that you'll look back on as you're older and think, you know, I did that. You know, and I'll be able to leave this business when it's time. I'm one of these people that stick around for years and years, you know. It's just like, I really want to, you know, once you finish, get out, you know. Get out with my head held high, knowing I did some good stuff. I wrote some good music, wrote some lyrics, I had a lot of great fans, and I'm going to do something else then.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for being such a cracking audience. Thank you very much to Carling for coming up with such a great concept. Thank you for coming. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I better get my wet clothes off.
Great night, mate.
I unbelievable.
Never seen JK
was great night.
Brilliant.
We can't argue.
Brilliant.
It's amazing to be that close to him and to kind of have that kind of atmosphere with a really, really small crowd.
His energy was fantastic. He gave us so much love.
It was down to earth. It was so down to earth. It was brilliant.
Touched his hand, or I'm never going to wash it again because he is the man.
Superb, absolutely superb. He might be airy, but he's fucking blinded.